Sea levels are rising, oceans are becoming warmer, and hotter temperatures are causing deadly wildfires.
How many first responders lose their lives because they walk into uncharted territories without good situation awareness?
Climate change poses a fundamental threat to our world and our livelihoods, and there is a need to find new, more effective ways to tackle the problem.
Robots don't necessarily assess climate change per se, but they can help the industries which are some of the biggest offenders in terms of creating climate change.
Green jobs are those that have a direct positive impact on the planet. But are they a priority for employers? And how do we encourage people to pursue a greener career?
If we tell people that there's hope, people would really care for the environment and would still try to make a change.
And welcome to Horizons on the Record. I'm Christina Francis, Executive Director for the Insights Incubation and Investment Arm at Jobs for the Future, called JFF Labs.
And I'm David Hsu, a Vice President at Jobs for the Future. JFF works at the national, state, and local levels, engaging leaders in education and workforce development, employers, entrepreneurs, and policymakers to achieve one goal: equitable economic advancement for all.
In this two-part episode of On the Record, we're going to be talking about a topic that affects all of us, climate change, or what many are calling climate resiliency, a more hopeful approach. The work to be done in the U.S. to ensure our collective future affects all sectors of the economy, our families, and our workforce. Specifically, we'll focus on the impact of climate work on jobs, the ones that exist today, and the ones we need to ensure a future that is environmentally, economically, medically, and socially just.
Today, there isn't a standard definition of green or climate resilient jobs. They can cross many, if not all, sectors, roles, and geographies.
This show will focus on California, not only America's most populated state, but the fifth biggest economy in the world. And California is experiencing some of the most dire effects of climate change. Higher temperatures and extreme heat waves, drought, and severe wildfires are plaguing the state, putting a strain on the power grid and threatening the environment and people's lives.
We'll be visiting some of the most innovative companies in the state to find out how they're developing green jobs, and we'll learn about the new technology that is literally helping to save lives. Stay up to date with all of JFF's work across the country and send us your thoughts and questions on LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook.
Green jobs are much more than the obvious positions we think of when we think of working to stop the effects of climate change. As the situation worsens, the need for diversification and new technology becomes even greater. I traveled to the Bay Area to learn about some groundbreaking technology that could change our ability to respond to one of California's most serious growing problems, wildfires. The World Economic Forum says that wildfire seasons have lengthened globally by 27% since the 1980s. Last year, there were nearly 60,000 wildfires in the United States alone, and California is the most affected state. Global warming creates higher temperatures, and that means more dry fuel available to burn. It also results in more persistent hot and dry weather, and that allows fires to intensify and spread. As wildfires increase, scientists are working hard to find new and innovative ways to tackle the deadly problem.
In 3, 2, 1.
I'm in Oakland, Northern California, to learn about a new technology that is literally helping to save lives. And they are called squishy robots.
So what you're about to see today is something that we call a drop test. Squishy robots are, probably best well known for being able to be dropped into very dangerous situations. And we have to be able to say with confidence, yes, you can drop this thing, because you can see, we have to be able to provide that guarantee, right?
They are sensor robots that can be air deployed into hazardous areas to provide persistent, ground level, real-time data. The robots are impact resilient, or squishy structures, that can be dropped into a danger zone from heights of up to 1,000 feet.
It means that emergency workers can properly assess and understand how to effectively fight a wildfire much more quickly, which means saving land and lives.
Robots don't necessarily assess climate change per se, but they can help the industries which are some of the biggest offenders in terms of creating climate change. So robotics can address particular problems that help industries do better in terms of climate change. But a robot is not going to go out and stop global warming by itself.
What are the skill sets that are needed for the robotics industry?
Robotics as an industry is a place where it used to require a PhD to play. That is no longer the case, thankfully. Math and science, software engineering are a big component, but at the end of the day, it's a team project. Robotics is many things at once, as indeed most problems in the 21st century require multiple disciplines at the same time. Nobody can do it all. So at the end of the day, it's a team sport.
The team is a majority female-owned startup that began as research at UC Berkeley with NASA to develop planetary probes for space exploration. The technology is now being used to help combat one of the most serious effects of climate change and global warming.
Squishy Robotics was a dream that I had when I was at the University of California at Berkeley as a professor of mechanical engineering. And I was working on a project with NASA to build planetary probes that would take delicate sensors in the probe, be able to circle a planet, survive the landing and walk away and doing scientific monitoring, or be shot out of a primary rover and survive as well. So it had to both be able to walk and be impact resistant. And when we finished the project with NASA, well, we were actually still continuing working with NASA, we were looking for earthly applications because we felt that there were real needs here on planet Earth. And we read a report from the Red Cross that talked about how many first responders lose their lives because they walk into uncharted territories without good situation awareness. And we started a program, and we found a niche in the area of protection from hazardous materials.
Particularly when you're working with a startup, you're generally working with new innovative technology. So I think one of the skill sets that's definitely required is people who are able to identify the problem, listen to the customer, and really empathize with the customer. At the end of the day, you know, just having great, cool technology doesn't do you any good. You really have to be solving a problem that needs to be solved, and you need to know how your solution will fit into their workflow to make that easy for them to utilize that technology.
The team hopes that the robots will soon be able to maneuver on the ground, even in rough terrain.
With first responders particularly, we've heard them say that the drone is a force multiplier. What used to require teams of first responders going out to scout out and get information and send that data back, a drone can do much faster. We like to think of our robots as now being a drone multiplier. A single drone can position several sensors into a location and get that data back. And it's really rewarding to see their excitement to start incorporating some of this technology. They're seeing how it enables them to do more without requiring more boots on the ground.
Climate resiliency is only possible if supporting policy exists. The Inflation Reduction Act, or IRA, passed by Congress, has been described as the most significant action that the U.S. has taken against climate change.
The IRA would invest $369 billion in energy security and climate change programs over the next 10 years. This means a reduction in our nation's carbon emissions by almost a billion tons. It would also create green jobs in manufacturing, technology development, energy access, and sustainable growth.
I spoke to Dr. Jalan White Newsom, who's the Senior Director of Environmental Justice for the White House Council on Environmental Quality. So thank you so much for joining us today.
Yeah, thanks for the opportunity.
So your title has the words environmental justice in it. What does that mean to you and your colleagues at the White House?
So when I think about environmental justice, it is something that we are working towards, the state of the environment that provides healthy air, clean water, and a safe place for folks to work, live, play, and pray. Essentially, from a government perspective, we have policies and practices and procedures that can either make that harder to achieve, or in our case with this administration, try and advance environmental justice. And so that is essentially what we're working towards.
And so you mentioned policy, and the Inflation Reduction Act has recently passed. Congratulations on that passage.
Yes.
How do you see that impacting environmental justice?
So what's amazing about the Inflation Reduction Act, it is the largest in history, I would say, contribution to climate and clean energy. And when you talk about climate change and clean energy and the impacts on low-income communities and communities of color, we need as much investment as possible. When you talk about reducing air pollution, that's a part of the IRA. When you talk about increased monitoring for pollutants, that's a part of the IRA. When you talk about clean energy and lowering folks' energy bills, that's a part of the IRA. I mean, when you talk about environmental justice, the fact that there have been communities across this country that have been underinvested in, that have been forgotten about, resources help. But most important is the way you direct those resources. And so also a part of the Biden administration is a tool called the Climate and Economic Justice Screening Tool, or CEJIS for short. And this tool basically is a geospatial mapping tool, which basically says these are the census tracts across the country that are considered disadvantaged, where we need to target resources. So you have this tool that helps you target and you have resources. And in that way, I think the IRA can help advance equity and environmental justice at the same time.
To make a lot of that happen, we're going to need to train the next generation of workers in this space. How do you see the IRA as really enabling that? And how are education and training providers going to help us get there?
One of the pieces of the IRA, the many pieces, include a component where, for example, there's incentives for businesses that are promoting clean energy and energy efficiency. As a part of that, it's also a real commitment to producing a lot of good jobs, but quality jobs for folks that are typically left out of that workforce. When we talk about clean energy jobs, jobs in energy efficiency, you know, it's important that we have a diverse workforce because most of the climate impacts are felt first and worst by Black and brown communities. So we want to make sure that those communities, one, have an advantage in terms of getting jobs and can benefit from it. You know, there's some intentional efforts to make sure that, you know, we're creating the talent pipeline that represents this country. And so, again, those are efforts with our community colleges, our educational institutions, philanthropy, private industry, that we want to fortify because that is really going to be the only way that we not only maximize the Inflation Reduction Act, but we actually get the workforce that we need to move this country to the clean energy future that we all deserve.
Jalam, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for your time.
To learn about the potential impact of IRA on climate-resilient jobs, let's speak to Veronica Eady. She is the Senior Deputy Executive Officer of Policy and Equity at the Bay Area Air Quality Management District and has worked in national organizations and federal agencies. She's joining us from San Francisco. Veronica, thanks for joining us.
Hi, great to be here.
So how are you viewing California's situation compared to other states and regions?
Well, you know, like other states and regions and like other places in the world, you know, we are feeling the significant effects of climate change. I'm sure your audience has heard about all of the terrible wildfires. And I can say that over the last 5 years, we probably had the worst wildfires since the state of California has been keeping record. In addition to that, you know, we're in the middle of a significant drought. And before that was a drought, I think we had maybe a 2 year or 3 year reprieve from that. These weather patterns, these wildfires are not going to let up, and we are not behaving as though they're going to let up. This is the new normal. It's the new normal here. You know, unfortunately, we're seeing, you know, hurricanes in Puerto Rico and the Caribbean and, you know, flooding. All of this is going to continue. And so we need to learn to adapt. We really need to be able to turn almost on a dime to change our economy. And so what does that mean? You know, here in the Bay Area, we have five large refineries. Now we have two of those refineries that are converting to renewable fuels. Still combustion though, still a challenge. But I mentioned the refineries because these refineries employ thousands of people. How do we shift the economy so that people have jobs, so that, you know, cities and towns, and some of them are quite small, that have relied on, you know, a fossil fuel economy for their main tax base. How do you make that shift and still provide dollars that support, you know, public schools, that, you know, support fire departments and things like that? We really need to be thinking about how we can adapt these economies and how we can adapt our workforce mm-hmm. and how we can do that rather quickly.
And that was Veronica Eady from the Bay Area Air Quality Management District.
Stay up to date with all of JFF's work across the country and send us your thoughts and questions on LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook.
We've talked a lot about the workforce and different types of green jobs, but campaigners and activists say that engaging with the issue is the first step and that inspiring young people to take action will be key. Our next film introduces an artist based in Santa Monica who is dedicating her career to the cause and inspiring young artists through a message of hope.
Hello, my name is Luciana Baid. I'm a visual artist. I'm originally from Argentina. Right now I'm a resident artist of 18th Street Art Center in Santa Monica. And for the last, I would say, 16 years, I've been developing artwork that mainly focuses on environmental issues and its impact on immigration. So I generally carry my camera with me, especially now that I live in California, when I go to the beach or when I go to lakes or rivers. And I am fascinated by the shapes of mountains most of the times. That's why in this exhibition and in many of my series, you will see mountains, whether it's mountains from the American West or it's mountains that are made out of ice and water, as in the Iceworks. This exhibition is entitled On the Verge because we are standing on the verge of a mountain. We can either be on the verge of something good or something bad, and I think it's up to humans to finally decide what's going to be our fate. My road trip series is based on photographs that I took all through the American West. As you can see, human beings are minuscule. And this also makes a reflection of how we humans, we are so small in relationship to our world, but still we are able to cause so much damage. These are photographs that I took on Lake Powell, the United States' second largest water reservoir. And right now it's only full up to 24%. So it's all incredible landscapes where I depict mountains and deserts. And at the same time, I'm showing how all these landscapes have changed by these drastic climate events. The way that I think that I can inspire people is by creating magnificent images that are beautiful, that are very colorful, that are super vivid in color, because I don't think people want to be approached with darkness and death, but on the contrary, they want to see the lively side of the world. So apart from working on photo-based works, I also work with photo sculptures and video as well. This piece is entitled The Maps That Failed Us. All the maps of the world assembled in a totally new and random order. So this talks about a world where nothing makes sense and the logical order has been totally lost. As you can see, the world has become mountains, and these mountains can also look like icebergs. So in a way, this work also talks about climate change. By presenting my work in different media and through new technologies, my hope is that we can reach these younger generations and inspire them to continue to fight.
Wow, what a powerful approach. Stay up to date with all of JFF's work across the country and send us your thoughts and questions on LinkedIn, Twitter, Instagram, and Facebook.
We'll have much more on climate change and green jobs in part two in just a few weeks' time. So be sure to take a look when we post that. Until then, goodbye.
Goodbye.